Morning to all of you all. I think what I'm supposed to speak today has already been covered in the past two talks, so I have hardly anything to add much to this. What I could do is definitely solve all the queries and the controversies that were raised. I also run the liver clinic at Wadia Hospital, so we've been using a lot of interferon, lamivudine, nadofovir, and I thought the first thing was the use of interferon in children. It's widely available, interferon alpha. It's expensive, but not that expensive as it has been quoted. The advantage of an interferon is it does not cause resistance. So even if you've used it in any patient with hepatitis B or C, you're not causing any resistance. The problem is that it's not going to give you a nice outcome. It's going to give you an outcome of getting an E antigen negative in only 30% of patients. The indication of using is only in the patients who are immunoactive phase and not in the immunotolerant phase. So most of the children vertically acquired would be in the immunotolerant phase when you get them. Hardly before the age of 18 you would be putting them onto an interferon because of the immunoactive phase. The other drugs, adefovir, is usually not recommended in children as the first line. It's going to be as a second line, especially in patients who are E antigen negative. And the combination therapy, we did try that at Wadia. We tried the combination therapy of interferon lamivudine earlier at Wadia and we had a very poor outcome. And then when you do a meta-analysis, you do find that combination therapy is not what is recommended currently. It's still monotherapy with interferon. Some centers have been using monotherapy with lamivudine, but lamivudine, if you're going to use long-term, you're going to land up with resistance. So the best thing would still be interferon. The other thing that was raised was about CMV and Valgan and Gancyclovir. We've been using a lot of Gancyclovir and Valgancyclovir in children with CMV hepatitis, neonatal hepatitis. And the one problem that I've been faced is never been able to document CMV in the liver tissue. I've given the thesis to my student this year to do a CMV PCR on the liver tissue. We are doing it with ICMR as a project. And hopefully we should be able to document that all this neonatal hepatitis was actually CMV. But till then, it's more of circumstantial evidence where we have a child who's got neonatal hepatitis, has a CMV, IgM positive, we do a viral load which is high, and we treat it because we find that the viral load is high and we do see a response. We've had a lot of publications on this, but it's all circumstantial. It's not evidence-based. It's not completely rational. The problem with Gancyclovir, it's an injection which is not available for the pediatric population. So if you're going to use it in neonates, you actually are going to spend 1,500 rupees per vial and you're going to waste that money because you need to throw that vial away. You can't use it the second time. We tried getting it pulverized, the powder, and into small vials, but that also doesn't work. Gancyclovir is available as enteric-coated capsules in children. Again, to get an enteric-coated capsule pulverized and to do it, duodenal intubation and to give Gancyclovir is absolutely difficult. So we were very happy when Valgancyclovir came into the market. There have been a lot of issues of pharmacokinetics with Valgancyclovir. There have been data of weight bands of 15 to 16 milligram per kg per dose 12 hourly. 2 500 milligram per meter square per day is what we've been using, and when I find that I use this dose, I find a lot of side effects. I get them to have neutropenia. Most of the patients, I need to stop the drug within a week or 10 days. So there are a lot of issues with Valgan with the current dose that we are using. Probably if we use a lower dose with 250 milligram per meter square per day, we would get a good outcome, which we've been getting by monitoring viral loads. But we've had problems, we've not been able to document whether it's causing resistance or not causing resistance. The indication of Gancyclovir or Valgancyclovir in children, basically FDA approved, is only two: CMV-induced retinitis, CMV-induced pneumonitis. It has been used in congenital CMV as a randomized control trial. There's only one trial which has documented that even in patients who are asymptomatic with congenital CMV, it decreases the incidence of hearing loss much less. We've been using it in CMV hepatitis as an off-label use, not as a part of an indication, but I think we need more randomized control trials to actually document that. So now I think I will start with my actual talk on antivirals. It's going to be a lot of repetition from the previous talks. As we know, viruses replicate in the host cell, and so eradication may also lead to loss of infected cell. So you have to be very careful when you're using antiretrovirals. We've had these classifications of antivirals into herpes agents, non-HIV, HIV agents, respiratory, hepatic. What I thought was classifying them into various areas where they act. So if we could have a virus acting at a particular antiviral at a particular level. So if you basically want to prevent the virus from entering the cell itself, so you have this HIV antiretroviral, which is known as Maraviroc, which does not act on the virus, but it acts on the CD4 cell. It acts at the CCR5 co-receptor. Then you have this T20, which is another anti-HIV drug, which is a fusion inhibitor. You have the amantadines and the pliconiril. Replication, which affects the viral replication. We've got a whole list of drugs. We've got the acyclovir, valacyclovir, the cyclovir family, ganciclovir, sidofovir. Among the ART, we've got the NRTIs, the NNRTIs, ribavirin, edifovir, entecavir. So we've got a whole list which act on the viral genome. Something that prevents integration is raltegravir. Then something that prevents the release of the virus, we've got the protease inhibitors and the oseltamivir. And something that blocks everything of the virus, the viral genome, the release, the integration, that's the interferons. Among the hospitalized patients, we've got very few drugs that we use. When we talk about antivirals, we think about viral encephalitis. We think of probably influenza. So these are the drugs that we've actually used. I already spoke about CMV. Now, acyclovir, a lot of pharmacokinetic has already been discussed. What I want to discuss is that it requires the first phosphorylation, requires a thymidine kinase, which has to be from the virus. Subsequent phosphorylation takes place by the cell kinases. So it's not very toxic to the non-infected cells, and that's the reason why it's used so much. It's used for basically HSV and varicella zoster. The side effects have already been discussed about nephrotoxicity, neutropenia if given in a very high dose, and occasionally neurotoxicity. The clinical use of acyclovir in hospital patients would be HSV encephalitis. Now here I want to discuss about viral encephalitis. We see a patient who comes with fever convulsion, we do a lumbar puncture, we get an aseptic meningitis kind of a picture, and we put the child on acyclovir. I would suggest that we should do an HSV PCR before we put the child on acyclovir. So whenever you're doing a CSF, collect an HSV PCR. Otherwise you're going to have this child in your hospital for 21 days taking acyclovir without any reason. So even before starting acyclovir, send the HSV PCR. The report will take 2 or 3 days. You can start acyclovir. If that HSV PCR comes negative, you can stop it. You don't need to give it for 21 days. It's already been discussed that we need to repeat an HSV PCR before stopping acyclovir. 21 days is the recommendation, but if the HSV PCR is still positive, you may have to continue the drug till the PCR is negative. Neonatal HSV infections, disseminated HSV, CNS HSV is what is used, and varicella zoster in compromised patients. Now the dosing was something that was updated last year. Till now we were all using 10 mg per kg per dose, 8 hourly. Subsequently it has been found that this is causing lower dose in the CSF, and it's been recommended now that in children up to the age of 12 years, you're going to use 60 milligram per kg per day, which is equivalent to your 500 milligram per meter square per day. So this is the new recommendation, that you need to go up to 60 milligram per kg per day in children up to 12 years. Beyond 12 years, you can still continue with 10 milligram per kg per dose. For herpes zoster and chickenpox, it's the same dose that you're going to use IV. Now, neonatal herpes simplex, earlier people used to use 30 milligram per kg per day for 10 days. They found that the CNS disease decreased by only 14% mortality. Whereas when they started using higher dose, 60 milligram per kg per day for 21 days, you did have mortality coming down to 4%. So this was the advantage of using higher dose of acyclovir in neonates, and that's why the recommendation of 60 milligram has come in neonates. Acyclovir resistance we do talk about, we hardly prove it. We talk about Foscarnet, I have never used it, so it's probably going to be a lot of theoretical knowledge that would be shared. And Foscarnet directly inhibits the DNA polymerase, so it does not require any of the kinases for activation. So it's very toxic. It's very, very toxic. It can affect the non-infected cells also. And it can cause a lot of nephrotoxicity as well as metabolic toxicity. And we have various dosings of foscarnet, but I don't think we need to know these doses because we are hardly using this drug. Now, sidofovir is one drug that I have tried in a few of my patients. It does not require, again, the viral enzymes for initial phosphorylation. So again, it's quite toxic. It can affect both the virus-infected and the non-infected cells. It's got a very poor oral bioavailability, so it has to be given IV. It has been used for a lot of indications. You have resistant HSV, resistant CMV. It has also actions against a lot of other viruses. Your varicella zoster, HHV6, EBV, HHV8, adenovirus. I've used it in a patient with adenovirus where we had a child with disseminated adenovirus and we tried to get sidofovir. It's not available easily. You do get it in the gray market. The problem is it's got a lot of nephrotoxicity, proteinuria, glycosuria. So to decrease that nephrotoxicity, you need to give hydration and you need to give probenecid along with sidofovir. And it's also known to be highly teratogenic and carcinogenic. So you need to be very careful when you're using this drug. You can't just use it left, right, center. It has to be an indicated use. And the dose is once a week. You need to give 5 mg per kg once a week as an induction phase, and then maintenance is 5 mg per kg every 2 weeks. Valganciclovir, we've already spoken about. Again, it requires phosphorylation, but it has activity against the cellular DNA polymerase also. So it's a very toxic drug as compared to acyclovir. The most important is the neutropenia, the myelosuppression that takes place. 5% will have some sort of a neurotoxicity. And animal studies definitely has shown carcinogenic, mutagenic, teratogenic effect. So be careful when you're using ganciclovir. Currently, it's indicated only in immunosuppressed patients, especially in transplant patients, bone marrow transplant or solid organ transplants. Congenital CMV only if you have a pneumonitis or a chorioretinitis or older children with chorioretinitis. The dose is 10 mg per kg per day, 12 hourly for 2 to 3 weeks. Now, this dosing or the duration is decided on the viral load. So you actually need to monitor the viral load and then decide how long you're going to give. Sometimes you may even go up to 6 weeks therapy. Now, ribavirin. Ribavirin is a broad spectrum antiviral agent. It has activity against both the RNA and the DNA viruses. It's more potent against the RNA viruses. And it works against a lot of viruses, myxovirus, paramyxo. That's the reason why you have ribavirin being used for RSV, to hepatitis C, to a lot of other agents. So you have this ribavirin. It's available as per oral. It's available as IV. It's supposed to be available as inhalational. Again, we've tried ribavirin in hepatitis C patients in combination with interferon. Have had excellent results in these patients. Ribavirin inhalational is a problem to get. We do get oral ribavirin, which we've tried in other patients, with, especially with HIV patients who've had co-infections with any of these viruses affecting the CNS. Recommended use, only RSV and only in combination with interferon for Hep C. The problem is it causes, these metabolites concentrate in the red blood cells, so it's going to cause a dose-related reversible anemia. And it's quite teratogenic. It's embryo lethal, so you don't use it in pregnant women at all. Now, the dose that is recommended for aerosolized ribavirin is 20 mg per ml of drug in the reservoir, administered for 12 to 22 hours per day for 3 to 6 days. And the systemic dose in adults is 4 grams per day. In adults and children, it's based on weight bands, which are not included here. The drug that we've been using left, right, and center is oseltamivir. Especially any child who comes with fever, cough, is admitted as bronchiolitis, goes on oseltamivir. The next month, this child comes with the same symptoms, not hospitalized, he's again put on oseltamivir. So probably we are using oseltamivir left, right, center 4 to 5 times a year in the same patient. And I think if somebody did a study on resistance, we would find resistance to oseltamivir in the community. It's specifically for influenza A and B. And I would suggest that if we are going to use this drug, why don't we do a rapid test of influenza before using this drug? You can do a throat swab, you can do a rapid test, you get the result in half an hour. If the child is having influenza A and B, go ahead and use this drug. But if there's no influenza and these symptoms were caused by para-influenza or say adenovirus or RSV, why do you want to use this drug? So if you could spend 150 rupees, half an hour, get the result, use the drug. Otherwise, don't use it so rampantly. The main side effects are nausea and vomiting, and there have been doses. Now, the recommendation is above 1 year of age using this drug. but I think most of the pediatricians are also using it in children less than 1 year of age. And we have these weight bands which were created by the Mumbai municipal corporation, which said 2 ml twice a day in children more than 6 months and 1 ml twice a day in children less than 6 months. And I don't know how they got those weight bands, because there are no recommendations for these weight bands in children less than 1 year. So duration of treatment is 5 days. You have to start it within 48 hours of having the symptoms. So if you have a child who's actually hospitalized, he must be having symptoms more than 4 days, this drug may not be working. So I conclude that there are very few antiretroviral agents available for hospitalized patients. Adverse effects limit the regular use of these drugs, and these drugs have to be used with caution. Thank you very much.